Hello and welcome to Political Theatre. India is the largest democracy in the world, and the twists and turns in the world of Indian politics attract everyone's attention. Several political developments take place simultaneously across the country, making it difficult for the people to keep a track of these events and understand their impact. In the next half an hour, we'll bring to you the top political events of the week and analyze and decode them for you. So let's begin with the big story of the week. The Aam Aadmi Party-led government in Delhi was thrown into a crisis this week, with the Election Commission reportedly recommending to the president the disqualification of 20 MLAs of the ruling party. The case relates to holding of office of profit by these MLAs.
The Aam Aadmi Party moved the Delhi High Court on Friday against the Election Commission's decision to disqualify 20 of its MLAs. However, the commission was unable to make a statement on whether it had forwarded a final opinion to the president. This prompted the High Court to decline an interim stay on the recommendation. An Aam Aadmi Party counsel argued before the court that the Election Commission failed to give the MLAs notice of hearing. The party also claimed that the panel did not consider their written submissions and replies.
23 June ke baad se aaj tak hamare kisi vidhayak ko bhi hearing ki tarikh aaj tak nahi batai gayi, koi suchna nahi di gayi, aur achanak kal 2 din pehle, vidai ke 2 din pehle, unhone jo ye 20 vidhayakon ki sadasyata radd karne ka gift diya hai. किसको दिया है क्यों दिया है इसके पीछे का समझौता क्या है ये आम आदमी पार्टी और ये देश जानना चाहता है
The opposition parties in the state, however, blamed the chief minister for this controversy and sought his resignation.
Morality of continuing in governance in Delhi with this kind of performance, half of them in jail, arrested and sometime went to jail, 20 disqualified, half of their ministers in fact resigned because of corruption cases. So that do they still have this morality of governing over Delhi? Magar jaise ki log kehte hain, naitikta aur Arvind Kejriwal ji ka dur dur tak koi sambandh nahi hai.
Kyon nahi ye log istifa dete, kyon nahi, kya inko satta ka moh itna zyada pyara ho gaya hai? Aaj hum logon ki ye mang hai, aaj hum log ghoshna karna chahte hain ki Delhi ke andar पूरी दिल्ली में कांग्रेस पार्टी केजरीवाल के भ्रष्टाचार के खिलाफ में आंदोलन चलाएगी
The allegations surfaced in March 2015 when the Delhi government appointed 21 MLAs as parliamentary secretaries. Justifying the appointments, the Delhi government said these parliamentary secretaries will assist cabinet ministers and also include more MLAs in governance work. Soon after, the appointments came under a cloud on grounds of legality and members holding office of profit. However, Delhi is not the first state to get into the office of profit controversy. West Bengal's Mamata Banerjee government appointed 24 parliamentary secretaries. Kolkata High Court called the move unconstitutional and the matter is now pending in the Supreme Court. The Karnataka government too appointed 11 MLAs and MLCs as parliamentary secretaries. The case is pending in High Court. Rajasthan government also has 10 parliamentary secretaries who enjoy the status of ministers of state. The state government passed a bill in October 2017 to give them constitutional validity, which has been challenged in the High Court. Officially, the Election Commission has not put out any communication in the matter. However, in the event that President Ramnath Kovind gives his assent and the MLAs are disqualified, it will still not pose a threat to the Arvind Kejriwal government, which currently has 66 members in the 70-member state assembly.
For more on this story, we're joined by our political analyst of the week, Mr. Naveen Upadhyay, political editor of The Pioneer. Mr. Upadhyay, welcome to Rajya Sabha Television.
Thanks.
Very interesting development, though it came a little later in the week. And this entire process has been, happening for almost 2 years now when the complaint was made. And now the Election Commission has made a recommendation to the president. There are two questions. One, what is going to be the political effect of this in the National Capital Territory region? And also constitutionally, how are we placed here? What are the ramifications?
You see, this was more or less expected. I think if you look in the background, so many people had to step down. Sonia Gandhi had to step down. Whole lot of other MLAs, MPs across the party lines have faced similar predicament. So I'm not surprised by the judgment, nor I question the EC judgment, I think. Now, as far as the political impact is concerned, there are two, you know. One, stability of the government. Is the stability of the government going to be impacted? One third of the MLAs go, no. I think absolutely there is no question of...
And they'll come down to 46 is the magic figure.
There is hardly, I mean, 2-3 members in opposition, so it is not going to impact the stability of the government. The second is, this is now going to lead to a mini assembly election of sorts in Delhi. So I think, you know, this is going to be very crucial. Even if Kejriwal does not win seats, still he retains his assembly, but this will be seen as a verdict on the sort of leadership he has been given, he has given in the last 2-3 years in Delhi. I personally don't think ki this entire, you know, the opposition attempt to create, you know, the, take a moral position on this is going to succeed. Because if you look at it, I was very amazed, you know, when I saw a leader like Ajay Makan saying ki the Aam Aadmi Party government should step down. Because Mr. Makan forgets that he himself was parliamentary secretary to Shiladishit. And just because nobody questioned that and he was not caught, I mean, he should not question, you know, the attached moral. Similarly, a lot of BJP leaders are also questioning Kejriwal. But again, I think they have done the similar things. Sahab Singh Barma's son was a parliamentary secretary. So I don't think, you know, this is going to be a major election issue in Delhi.
Okay. One very important question asked here, Mr. Upadhyay, is the fact that just recently, three AAP candidates have made it to Rajya Sabha. You know, there were Rajya Sabha polls which were held, and all these MLAs had voted in that particular election. So if this decision is finally ratified by the president, then will it have any impact on the election of those AAP MPs in the upper house?
I don't think so. Because retrospective effects, I don't think this can... impact the election outcome. Though, of course, I mean, you raised a very valid point, because the similar point, Aam Aadmi Party government is also raising, when the notification itself was struck down by Delhi High Court, that when they were appointed parliamentary secretary, that notification was struck down by Delhi High Court. So now they are saying, when they were not parliamentary secretary,
how can a decision be taken against them?
So similarly, this question which you are asking, that also, you know, deals with this aspect of whether a decision can have a retrospective impact. And in that case, of course, I mean, it's important, and I think the courts and the election commission will have to go into that.
Okay, so clearly that we can leave to the election commission, the courts and the parliament. But politically speaking, this is a very, very important development for all the political parties involved. That's Aam Aadmi Party, the Congress and the BJP. We'll take a short break here, but when we come back, we will give you the details of the announcement of assembly elections in three northeastern states and the issue of withdrawal of Hajj subsidy. Stay tuned.
Art arisen from a multi-hued cultural canvas. Tradition and cultural fervor dating back centuries. And encircling them all, there's a magic that awes. Embrace your nation's brilliant human warmth. Watch Colors of India, Sundays at 9:30 p.m. on Rajya Sabha Television.
Welcome back. The election process was set in motion in three northeastern states this week. The Election Commission announced assembly polls to be held in single phase in Tripura, Nagaland and Meghalaya from 18th Feb to 27th of Feb. The results in all three states will be announced on 3rd of March.
Publication of the electoral roll was
the Election Commission announced the polling schedule this week for three northeastern states, Tripura, Meghalaya and Nagaland. Election for the 60-member assembly seats in Meghalaya and Nagaland will be held on 27th February. Polling in Tripura, which also has 60 seats, will be held on 18th of Feb. Counting of votes in the three states will be held on 3rd of March. The tenure of all three assemblies is set to expire in March. Chief Election Commissioner A.K. Jyoti also confirmed that VVPAT will be used along with EVMs during polling in all three states. With the announcement of poll dates, the Model Code of Conduct has also come into force.
The photo voter slips would be distributed to all the households, to the voters, 7 days before the date of poll. And the Commission has directed all the chief electoral officers and the DOs that these slips are to be distributed only by the BLOs and they are not to be given to the political party workers. As far as number of polling stations is concerned, Meghalaya has got 3,082 polling stations, Nagaland 2,187, and Tripura has got 3,214.
The Meghalaya Assembly is currently led by Congress under the leadership of Mukul Sangma, which won 29 seats in the previous election. CPM is in power in Tripura since 1993 with Chief Minister Manik Sarkar serving his fourth term. The Naga People's Front with BJP support under the leadership of T.R. Jalyang is holding fort in Nagaland. While BJP is looking forward to strengthening its hold further in Northeast, both Congress and CPIM are trying to retain their political influence in their respective turfs. The three Northeastern states are among eight in the country to go to polls in 2018.
Our political analyst for the week, Mr. Naveen Upadhyay, is still with us. Once again, the elections, and this time around in the northeastern corner of the country. These three states, which will go to polls in the later half of the February, are considered to be very crucial, interestingly, for BJP also this time around. BJP is trying to make the inroads into Northeast after winning Assam. How significant do you believe it is for the BJP and what kind of success quotient it might have, specifically in the states like Tripura, which has CPM in power for almost more than 4 to 5 terms now?
You know, I think these elections are very, very, I think they are smaller states and in normal circumstances, people did not give much significance, you know, importance to the elections, outcome of these elections. But now the way the BJP is trying to expand itself in Northeast, you know, from that point of view, it's this thing very crucial because BJP wants to have a clear goal. They want to capture the entire Northeast. And then you are pitted against formidable left in Tripura, where I think it's going to be the bitterly fought election because left is there for last 20, more than two decades. And BJP has made very, very serious concerted efforts. There are a lot of MLAs on its side. There is a sort of, you know, anti-incumbency. So, you know, if you see at it, and BJP is trying to, you know, propagate its own agenda, you know, the Hindutva agenda in a very subtle way. Also development plank, you know, there are a lot of, if you see recently, I think a lot of decisions the government has taken, which really aim at moving the voters. For example, you know, the air ambulance to reach out to affected people in Northeast. So this election, I think Tripura is going to be between BJP and left in a big way. And in Meghalaya, the Congress and BJP, other parties are not, there are of course regional parties.
Nagaland BJP.
Nagaland BJP is already, you know, in alliance sort of government there. I think they are going to, this is Nagaland politics is very complex. There are small regional outfits, Congress is there, left is there, there are small regional, but I think there also BJP is better placed. So I would say that these elections, for BJP, it's very crucial.
So it is going to be very crucial and interesting elections in these three northeastern states, which are otherwise small states and have assembly strength of just 60 members each. We'll keep an eye on the political developments there and keep you updated. But meanwhile, let's take a look at another story in which after the Supreme Court's verdict, the NDA government has decided this week to withdraw the Hajj subsidy to Muslim pilgrims. According to an estimate, it will save around 700 crores annually, which the government says it will spend on the education of girl child from the Muslim community.
The central government this week announced its decision to withdraw Hajj subsidy given to Muslims for their annual pilgrimage. The government said that the decision is in line with its efforts to empower minorities without appeasement. The centre's decision followed the 2012 Supreme Court decision of phasing out Hajj subsidy by the year 2022 and use the saved money for welfare-oriented activities.
Hajj subsidy 2018 ke Hajj ke baad nahi rahegi. 2018 mein ke Hajj mein nahi rahegi. Jo Hajj subsidy thi, us Hajj subsidy ka jo samaj ke शैक्षणिक सशक्तिकरण में इस्तेमाल होगा.
But a skeptical Congress party urged BJP to ensure that the funds are utilized for the same.
इस पैसे को अल्पसंख्यकों की एजुकेशन के लिए, जो गरीब हैं, जो यतीम हैं, जो पढ़ नहीं सकते हैं, झुग्गी झोंपड़ियों में रहते हैं, उनकी शिक्षा के लिए और एजुकेशन को मॉडर्नाइज करने में ये पैसा लगाएंगे.
AIMIM President Asaduddin Owaisi asked if the BJP would stop giving funds to Hindu pilgrims.
मैं बीजेपी आरएसएस से पूछना चाहता हूं कि 800 करोड़ रुपए योगी सरकार ने पिलग्रिमेज के दिए हैं, काशी, अयोध्या, मथुरा किस में दिए हैं? पिलग्रिमेज रिजुविनेशन एंड स्पिरिचुअलिटी ऑगमेंटेशन में. और योगी सरकार ये भी कह रही है कि जो भी मनसरोवर यात्रा को जाएगा 1.5 लाख रुपये सब्सिडी देंगे. क्या ये खत्म करेंगे? मेरा चैलेंज उनको है.
However, the All India Muslim Personal Law Board said that the government's decision on revoking Hajj subsidy has no meaning as there was no such concession and Muslims were being cheated in its name.
ये मुसलमान बहुत दिनों से ये बात कह रहे हैं कि आप सब्सिडी हमको बिल्कुल ना दें, लेकिन हमको ये अख्तियार दे दें कि हम जिस एयरलाइन से जाना चाहें उस एयरलाइन से जाएं, ताकि उसका किराया आपके किराए से 1/3 होगा, आधे से भी कम होगा.
The Hajj subsidy refers to the discounted airfares given to Mecca-bound pilgrims who fly by government-owned Air India. It also included assistance for domestic travel within India to reach special airport terminals meant for Hajj departure. The Ministry for Minority Affairs had constituted a 5-member panel headed by former Secretary of Minority Affairs Afzal Amanullah in January this year to formulate a new Hajj policy in the light of the Supreme Court's 2012 order. According to Minority Affairs Minister Mukhtar Abbas Naqvi, the government spent over 250 crore rupees last year on subsidizing the annual pilgrimage of Muslims to Saudi Arabia.
Mr. Upadhyay is still with us. Mr. Upadhyay, again, you know, this is something which was in the offing. Supreme Court had already said that you should phase it out by 2022 completely, and this should be utilized for other purposes. This has been welcomed by other parties as well, the Congress, the main opposition party, though there have been voices of dissent. What exactly is the situation here as far as, you know, subsidy for religious pilgrimage is concerned?
I think this decision has been universally welcomed, and I think right decision, because Supreme Court had also said that. And why should I and you pay for anybody's religious faith? And if somebody wants to undertake a pilgrimage, they should pay. Mm-hmm. But the question arises, you know, why you don't have the same standard and same yardstick for other communities or mm-hmm. religion? Mm-hmm. For example, I mean, if you have noticed recently, a lot of states, Delhi also, BJP ruled Madhya Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, they have come out with schemes and proposals. If you are above 60 years old and you want to undertake pilgrimage of so many sites, mm-hmm. the state will pay for it. Mm-hmm. Similarly, certain states pay for Mansarovar Yatra, mm-hmm. and some of them are even BJP ruled states. So I question, you know, these sort of things should end. Mm-hmm. My personal view is, if you are going to end for one religion, then end it for all religion. Otherwise, people will not trust you. People will think these are political decisions. A whole lot of Supreme Court decisions have never been implemented. For example, Lokpal and this and that. So you take, pick up and, you know, one decision, implement it, say okay, this is good, Supreme Court had said this. I will personally feel that I think if universally, nobody should pay. Why should we pay for somebody's Mansarovar Yatra or somebody above 60 wants to go to Jodhpur or wherever?
Okay, so clearly what you're pointing out is that all this money which is being spent on the religious pilgrimage should be spent on better schemes, social welfare schemes such as education and health sector. We'll take a short break here, but when we come back, we will give you the details of other political developments across the country. Stay tuned.
Tales that inspire. Stories of social change. A salute to diversity. Promoting public discourse. Events that motivate. Inspiring the innovative spirit. Watch watch Rajya Sabha television documentaries.
Welcome back. From political developments in Karnataka to Uttar Pradesh, let's take a look at what else made news in the political arena across the country this week.
Ahead of elections in Karnataka, two Janata Dal secular MLAs joined BJP this week. MLAs Manappa Vajjal and Dr. Shivraj Patil, representing Lingasugur and Raichur constituencies, resigned from the assembly, alleging that their party had sidelined them for over a year. Meanwhile, BJP state president B.S. Yedurappa welcomed both MLAs to the party, saying many other legislators from JDS and Congress want to join the BJP ahead of the state election. Supreme Court has given a green signal for the All India release of Sanjay Leela Bansali's film Padmavat. The Apex Court stayed the notification and order issued by four states, Madhya Pradesh, Haryana, Rajasthan and Gujarat, banning the release of the film. In its interim order, the court said all the states are constitutionally obliged to maintain law and order and prevent any untoward incident during the screening of the film, after permission has been granted by the Central Board of Film Certification. While Congress has welcomed the decision, some BJP leaders have decided to file a review petition. Rahul Gandhi visited his constituency Amethi this week for the first time after taking charge as the Congress president. Addressing a public meet, Rahul once again criticized central government on the issue of demonetization and GST. Scuffle also broke out in Amethi between Congress and BJP supporters over posters of Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Rahul Gandhi. In a fresh attack on her rivals, BSP President Mayawati called BJP and Congress partners in crime. Addressing a press conference on her 62nd birthday this week, Mayawati claimed that both Congress and the BJP were dividing the society on the lines of casteism and communalism since independence. Mayawati hailed her party and said BSP was the only party that was working on the policies of Baba Saheb Ambedkar.
Several political developments led to interesting comments from political leaders in a bid to counter each other's claims. We've shortlisted the best ones for you in Face Off.
जो मामला पब्लिक डोमेन में आ जाता है और वो पब्लिक डोमेन में उन्हीं की वजह से आया, उनके रिश्तेदारों, उनकी बीवी की वजह से आया और जाहिर है कि ये मामला जो है बहुत आगे बढ़ चुका है और अगर आज वो ये बात कह रहे हैं तो ये समझने की ज़रूरत है उनको हैरेस कौन कर रहा है। अगर किसी चीज़ पर कोई शुबा है तो उसकी तहकीकात करना कानून का काम है।
अबाउट जस्टिस लोयास केस, हिज फैमिली मेंबर्स आर सेइंग दे डोंट सी एनीथिंग रॉन्ग, दे डोंट वांट एनी काइंड ऑफ what she calls a probe or anything like that, and they are themselves saying, the son is saying, which is I read it in the papers and other media, that they are being pressurized by a set of individuals. When it comes to the Supreme Court, this institution will do what is best for the institution, its credibility, and also for the larger dispensation of justice.
Aapne ek baar bata do, Narendra Modi ji ki kaun si yojana ne aapko fayda pahunchaya, mujhe naam bata do. स्वच्छ भारत हो गया साफ हिंदुस्तान, मेक इन इंडिया मिल गया रोजगार, बैंक के सामने खड़ा कर दिया, कहते काले धन के खिलाफ लड़ाई लड़ रहे, एक के बाद एक झूठ।
राहुल गांधी जी को मैं सुझाव दूंगा कि उस सकारात्मक राजनीति पर ध्यान दें तो उन्हीं का हित होगा, प्रदेश के विकास की तो मैं कांग्रेस उम्मीद नहीं करता, लेकिन राहुल गांधी यहाँ से सांसद हैं तो जिस अमेठी से सांसद हैं अमेठी के विकास में भी योगदान दें, अपनी ऊर्जा को जाया न करें।
आज आम आदमी पार्टी की पोल खुल गई, ये सरकार वास्तविकता में लोगों की दुकानें सील करवाना चाहती है और यहाँ पे घड़ियाली आंसू बहाना चाहती है और सच सामने आ गया, क्योंकि इतना कहने और करने के बाद भी दिल्ली में सीलिंग रुक सके, लोगों को राहत मिल सके, इस पर मंत्री बयान देने को तैयार नहीं।
क्या ये सीलिंग MCD से पहले भी हो सकती थी, इलेक्शन से पहले भी हो सकती थी, अभी क्यों हुई? तो इसका मतलब इनको लोगों ने सब प्लान है, इस तरह से चलता रहेगा, ये लोगों को व्यापारियों को छोटे व्यापारियों को चाहते ही नहीं है दिल्ली के अंदर व्यापार करें, उन लोगों के व्यापार बंद करने पर आतुर हैं और व्यापारियों के बिल्कुल खिलाफ हो चुके हैं।
Apart from television studios, protest marches and public rallies, politicians were also busy taking a dig at each other and making their claims on social media. Let's take a look at what all transpired in the virtual world of Indian politics.
The BJP this week continued to bat for Aadhaar's merit on social media. From its official handle, BJP called Aadhaar a tool for empowering citizens. The party tweeted a cartoon comparing the status of its schemes with the UPA government. While the cartoon showed UPA's social security schemes ruined by corruption and bureaucracy, it listed out the benefits of the same schemes during the NDA regime. BJP's tweet on Aadhaar came a day after Rahul Gandhi from his official Twitter handle attacked the centre for turning the project started by his party into a weapon to disempower citizens. The Congress president said that UPA's Aadhaar was a voluntary scheme to empower Indian citizens. The centre is doing just the reverse. Both parties also battled it out on social media on other issues, including the Barmer oil refinery in Rajasthan. BJP, from its official handle, credited the Prime Minister for launching the Rajasthan oil refinery project and alleged that the project was not moving ahead when Congress was ruling the state. The Congress, however, accused the BJP of delaying the project. In a tweet, Congress said that the BJP government's protests against the project resulted in youth unemployment in the state. The party alleged that BJP is re-inaugurating the project, which was already launched by the Congress, only to discredit the Congress. After the Election Commission's recommendations to the President to disqualify AAP MLAs, Leader of Opposition in Delhi Assembly Vijender Gupta called the proposed disqualification a huge moral defeat for Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal and demanded his resignation on ethical grounds. Joining the demand for Kejriwal's resignation, Delhi Congress President Ajay Makan wrote on Twitter, "Kejriwal has no right to continue as half of his cabinet ministers face corruption charges." But AAP leaders took to Twitter to defend their party. Raghav Chadha, national spokesperson of AAP, termed it as vendetta politics. Breaking his silence on Twitter, Arvind Kejriwal said that hurdles naturally come when one walks on the path of truth. He said that truth will triumph in the end.
So this was the summary of all political developments across the country this week. We'll be back again next week with some more interesting information and its analysis. Till then, we will leave you these visuals of the week. Keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.